Hey everybody, I want to talk about mold and mycotoxins and biotoxin illness in general. I'm Dr. Philip Oob. I'm a functional medicine doctor here in Austin, Texas, and I'm a mold literate doctor in case you're looking for a mold literate doctor. So in some of my other videos, I've talked about the generic toxins and detoxification, and I've mentioned mold and mycotoxins several times, but now I'm actually going to go into a little deeper into the mold and mycotoxins. I would really encourage you to start with that overview on toxins and detoxification before you jump into the specifics of mold and mycotoxins, because it's very important to understand this whole toxins and detoxification process and pathway and how each one fits in. And although you can identify yourself in a lot of these different categories, it's very important to try and understand what is your number one smoking gun, what should you go after first. And the general rule of thumb is you should always go after the gut first. So after you're done fixing the gut, then we start going after mold and mycotoxins. But the mold and mycotoxins is a really big deal, and most people don't even realize it. We ask every patient in our practice when they come in what mold exposures they've had, what mold have they been around, what water leaks have they had, and most people don't really know if they've had any water leaks or if they've been exposed to mold. And then when their mold results come back positive, then they really start thinking and they start reminiscing on, oh, there was that old water leak, or oh, that kitchen sink or plumbing leak or whatever it may be. So I would really encourage you to think very hard about your susceptibility and exposure to mold and mycotoxins, because pretty much every chronic illness patient we have, whether that be heart attacks, strokes, autoimmunity, fatigue, brain fog, whatever it may be, has an element of mold and mycotoxins in them. Most people don't understand, including doctors, these different phases of mold and mycotoxins. So I want to start at the very beginning. It's a chicken or the egg scenario, or mold and mold spore scenario. So we're going to start with the egg. The mold spore is where this whole process begins. It is the seed, it is the egg, it is the non-living life form of the mold, but at any moment it is ready to turn into and blossom as a full-grown mold. So we've all seen mold before. You leave bread out too long, or you leave coffee grounds in the coffee maker for too long, like I did in med school a few times. And when you go to open it and close it up, it's like growing new flowers in there. None of them are pretty or smell good. But those are the live, living, growing mold. How did that mold get there? It was already in the air. It was already in the coffee grounds as a mold spore. And all it needed was water and oxygen and the right temperature, and it hatches and becomes a mold. So as you can see here, I've colored it in. It's a dark mold spore. All it needs is water and food in order to become a mold. Once that mold is living and growing, it then makes more mold spores, and it can spread that via the air. It can just release and shed hundreds, if not thousands, of these mold spores to go and spread and produce elsewhere. But it can also locally spread. And that's what everyone thinks of as mold when they see the rings or the black mold growing in their shower or on their windows or whatever it may be. Mold likes to grow in a circular pattern. Fungi do in general like to grow in a circular pattern. And that's because of their local spread. But they're also growing via air or spreading via air. Those mold spores are looking for another wet place with food. Once it finds that, it hatches and, of course, starts the life cycle over. That part makes sense. Most people understand that. But what people really have a hard time grasping is this mycotoxin section of the life cycle. So there are thousands of molds out there, thousands of molds, and only a dozen of them or so actually are toxic and make mycotoxins. Now, in general, if you're living in mold, I don't care if it's a toxic or a non-toxic mold, you should probably get out of it, and we will address that in some of the other videos. But if you are living in a toxic mold, that is an especially dangerous problem, because toxic molds make airborne products or molecules called mycotoxins. And I specifically drew it this way so that you would understand that the mycotoxin is just that. It is a toxin. It is a chemical. It is an airborne problem. It is not alive. It is not living. It is not growing. It is just a toxin. Just like a chemical plant makes chemicals, the mycotoxin itself is airborne and completely separate from the factory. This is the factory. This is the chemical. Why is this a big deal? It's a big deal because these two things are treated completely differently. Mold is living, live, growing, eating food, multiplying, and making more and more mycotoxins and more mold spores. That is killed. That needs to be killed. Mycotoxins need to be detoxified. So you can move out of the mold, But if the mold is growing inside you, inside your sinuses, inside your gut, as I've listed down here, the two places we like to grow it are sinus, lungs, and gut. That's three places. But primarily the respiratory tract and the gut loves the sinuses. So if you've got mold in you, you can't ever get all the mycotoxins out because it's growing inside you. So step one is get out of the mold, wherever it may be. Step two is get the mold out of you, in your sinuses and in your gut, then you can finally start the process of getting rid of the mycotoxins. Now, mycotoxins are in a special type of problem because they are a chemical, because they are this fatty soluble looking thing with some water soluble components. You need to know what that terminology means yet until we get into the detoxification area. But basically, mycotoxins can go everywhere in your entire body, anywhere. It can go to your brain, it can go to your heart, your liver, your lungs, anywhere and everywhere. This is a chemical that, because it's both water and fat soluble, it can dissolve straight through your cell membranes and then dissolve right into your cytosol, the inner structure of your cell, and then bind to DNA, bind to your cell wall, bind to proteins, bind to anything and everything, and then it renders it less effective. The whole reason for this mycotoxin is this mold is trying to grow and it's trying to spread. It has learned, if it creates mycotoxins, that it can inhibit other molds from growing, which just so happens that it also inhibits human life forms and causes inflammation and damage to your liver and your brain and everything else. But when this mold grows indoors and it's creating all this mycotoxin, it's now growing unopposed. There's no other molds indoors for it to fight with. Outside, there's thousands of molds for it to fight with. But when it's growing inside, it doesn't have to fight against anything, and it just starts spewing mega and mega amounts of mycotoxins and mega amounts of mold spores and more molds. So it spells a tremendous problem when it's growing inside or when it's growing inside of your body. So where can you find each one of these components? Let's start with the mold spore, the egg. The mold spore can be found anywhere that has been plant-based or outdoors at some point or other. So what I like to point out is drywall is the number one place that mold, you will frequently find mold in your drywall or in your particle board or plywood. Anything that's got wood in it is quite porous and not thick, hard wood that was straight from the tree. Anything that involves the bark of the tree, the outside of the tree, is almost always going to have mold spores inside of it. So you can find it in drywall, you can find it in ceiling tiles, you can find it in wood, you can find it in anything that was basically produced from the outside. Those mold spores are there, and they're not alive, they're not causing any problems until you add water. The food source is the actual wood, the ceiling tile, the drywall. That is cellulose. Wet cellulose feeds mold, and that's all it takes to get started. Indoors is already the right temperature to spread mold, so all it needs is really water and food and oxygen, but that's already present. So once you develop the mold, then the mold can grow almost anywhere. So it loves wet places, of course. So in the drywall, in your wood, in your ceiling tiles is where it will already grow. But then it can start to spread to other places like air conditions. Air conditions are always wet. They're always, especially in Texas, they're always running. So they always have that moisture, which is perfect for mold. Once the mold gets into your air condition, then it can literally blow in every room of the house. So if you have mold anywhere, even if you're not in that room, that mold will spread to your air condition, and from that air condition, it will spread all around the house. Now, even if it's not growing inside of the air condition, it can still blow the mold, the mycotoxins or mold toxins all around the house, because remember, these are chemicals. So on a brief note on that, you can filter out mold and even mold spores with those HEPA filters, but mycotoxins are tiny little chemicals or tiny little molecules. So they are not gotten rid of with a HEPA filter. This is, we'll address that in another section, but this is especially difficult to get rid of. So mold, of course, loves to grow in chronic water leaks into these drywall ceiling tiles. So anywhere that might have been a water leak at some time, if it was not dried out completely or completely renovated, completely removed, you might be growing mold there and not even know it. Anywhere that's wet and damp. Now, I would also like to point out that toilets and showers and things like that, they frequently grow mildew. These are not considered toxic molds. These are easily cleaned and usually on the caulking or the tile or something, easily cleaned, not a lot of mold toxins coming from those. So although that is a mold, technically, we don't like to consider those terribly dangerous. Everyone has mildew in their showers.